When you get the soil test results back, there are often some interpretations and recommendations associated with those results. This is an example report from the University of Wisconsin Soil and Plant Analysis Lab for a garden soil. And if you have a coordinator, this is probably an activity that you'll go over together, is understanding how to interpret this soil test report. So it gives you the pH. It'll tell you if that pH is low, sufficient, or high based on the crop that you're attempting to grow. Same thing for phosphorus and potassium. I said there's no good soil test for nitrogen, but the tests often come with a recommendation for how much nitrogen to apply, which is based on our understanding of the nitrogen need or nitrogen requirement for various crops. Lawns will have a different nitrogen requirement than tomatoes, which will have a different requirement from annual flower beds. So the laboratory usually gives you some sort of guideline for how much nitrogen to apply to that crop. Speaking of nitrogen, it is critical for leafy growth. And often nitrogen deficiencies are associated with slow or limited growth. However, you can absolutely have excessive nitrogen, which promotes leafy growth over development of the fruit or vegetable. It also tends to cause a limited root system, which will decrease the plant's tolerance to drought or to heat stress. So finding that nitrogen is a Goldilocks nutrient, where you need to be right in the middle, just right. Too little will cause problems, and too much will also cause problems. Unfortunately, we do not have a good soil test for nitrogen at the moment. Phosphorus is a nutrient that is much easier to manage. It's very important for stimulating root growth, especially for new plants and for inducing flowering and having good, healthy fruits and vegetables. If you're short on phosphorus, you're going to have limited flower production, limited fruit production, and poor root development. And there's not a symptom associated with a plant symptom associated with too much phosphorus, but it is a really important pollutant of our water bodies here in the state and throughout the United States. So we like to keep our phosphorus just at that level where it's critical for plant growth. If we put down too much, we run the risk of adding to the pollution of surface water bodies. Potassium is another macronutrient. It's often deficient, and potassium is associated with disease resistance and winter hardiness and heat and drought stress tolerance. So it's often associated with a lot of plant stresses. Deficiencies are hard to spot. They usually are associated with a whitening or a yellowing of the interveinal areas. And sometimes the leaf margins will get this black look to them, as you can see in the picture there. It's a very subtle deficiency. This is a pretty extreme picture. So soil testing is a really good way to make sure that you have enough potassium in the soil. Not too many problems associated with excess potassium. It is not an environmental pollutant like phosphorus is, and it does not cause plant problems if applied in excess. But it's expensive, it's a non-renewable resource, and we want to make sure that we're following soil test guidelines when we're applying potassium. Your soil test will also give you an idea of the amount of organic matter in the soil. Usually, like we said, between 2 and 4%. And organic matter is really important for improving the water holding capacity of the soil. And it's important for creating a looser, better soil structure, which allows for better oxygen getting into the soil. And it also is one of the main storehouses of the nutrients that the plant relies on for growth. The pH will also be indicated on the soil test report. So this is, like we talked about in the first section, plants have a very specific pH range. Certain plants prefer low, other plants prefer high. So if your pH is out of that optimum for the plant that you're attempting to grow, you're going to need to attempt to adjust it. Increasing pH is usually the easiest adjustment to make. So acidic soils that need to be raised up. Let's say we're trying to grow a nice healthy lawn, our pH is 4. We're going to need to get that pH to 5.5 or 6. And the soil test will tell us that our pH is 4, and if we say we're trying to grow a lawn, it will also know that we need to get it up to 6, or so, and it will tell us how much lime or calcium carbonate we need to add to get to that target. So that's a very useful function of a soil test. So lime is sold in a bunch of different grades. The finer that material is, the smaller the particle size, the faster it's going to react. Lime is relatively immobile, which means if we broadcast it onto the surface, it's going to take a long time for that material to move down deep into the profile. So it's best if we can till that lime into the root zone and incorporate it throughout rather than waiting for it to happen naturally. Decreasing pH is much more complicated, and I often recommend against it because the high pH soils tend to be built out of limestone particles, calcium carbonate. And so they're often very difficult to lower the pH, whereas lime, increasing pH is relatively simple. Decreasing pH is very difficult. We recommend if you need to decrease your soil pH, product that we often recommend is sulfur, not sulfate, but sulfur, elemental sulfur, which is a yellow compound, or something containing aluminum, and usually it's aluminum sulfate. The aluminum sulfate causes an immediate chemical reaction which will lower the pH. The elemental sulfur is a biologically mediated pH reduction, which means it takes longer. It's more like a slow release process. I prefer the sulfur option because there is more room for error if you overapply than aluminum sulfate, which tends to, because it's an immediate reaction, tends to be less forgiving. But again, for both of these, decreasing pH can be an impossible task in certain soils. So it's often better if you have a high pH to say, well, let's look for plants that can tolerate high pH rather than to plant low pH plants and keep chasing that soil pH, which can take years, decades, if not centuries, to lower, depending on the original parent material. Okay, to sweeten your soil means to A, raise the pH, B, lower the pH, C, add C6H12O6, otherwise known as glucose, sugar, and D, apply manure. So, sweeten your soil means to raise the pH or apply lime, is what that term means. So, agriculture is a naturally acidifying process. So, farmers got in the habit of, after so many crop cycles, you sweeten your soil, you put down lime, and it's just what you do to grow good plants. And unfortunately, that practice has kind of seeped into the general consciousness of how we grow plants in gardens. And so, unfortunately, it's basically not true. You should always be adjusting your soil based on a soil test, not because it's always good to sweeten your soil every other year. So, get that soil test, understand your pH, and manage your pH based on those results. But don't fall into the habit of simply applying lime because it's just what you need to do to sweeten it up. Getting kind of closer to the end here, we're going to start talking about some general fertilizer recommendations. I recommend avoiding against high nitrogen fertilizers for most crops. Sweet corn, potato, and turf grass are some of those exceptions, which have a higher nitrogen demand. Also, on the other hand, avoid uniform low-grade fertilizer. The classic example is a 10-10-10. The three numbers listed on a fertilizer bag are always the first number is nitrogen, the second number is phosphorus, the last number is the percentage of potassium. So 10% nitrogen, 10% phosphorus, 10% potassium. Plants don't use nutrients in that same ratio. So what happens when you use a 10-10-10 is you're basically overdosing the phosphorus and potassium. And phosphorus has an environmental implication, so we want to avoid overdosing phosphorus whenever possible. Micronutrients are generally not needed. The soil often has a high enough supply of micronutrients where you shouldn't be needing to apply them regularly unless you have a soil test that's telling you something else. And adjust your pH as necessary depending on the soil and the crop. Organic fertilizers are interesting, and I like to use and recommend organic fertilizers in a lot of situations because they're chemically complex. Organic implies they're based on a life form, contain carbon, they're naturally occurring, and from a social side of it, they're byproducts or waste products. They need to go somewhere, and so this is in the vein of reduce, reuse, recycle. Now, microorganisms must degrade these fertilizers for them to react and to become plant available. So they tend to be naturally slow release, and the rate at which they're broken down varies depending on the type of material that it was made from. Poultry manure, dairy manures tend to provide fairly quickly available nitrogen. Things like municipal city composts tend to provide nitrogen at a much slower rate. And they will improve the soil structure with long-term use because you're essentially adding organic material, organic matter, to the soil. Here's a list of some organic fertilizers. Blood meal. Blood has a relatively high amount of nitrogen relative to phosphorus and potassium. Bone meal, we always hear in school, you need calcium for strong bones. But the other component of calcium is phosphate. Your bones are made of calcium phosphate. So fertilizers from bone meal have a high percentage of phosphorus. Tree leaves, 0.7% nitrogen, 0.1% phosphorus, 0.8% potassium. They're relatively stingy, right? When those leaves fall off the ground, the plant's done everything it can to suck those nutrients back for the next season's growth. Green sand is a material that has a relatively high amount of potassium. And then activated biosolids, this would be a product like milorganite, which is coming from the wastewater treatment plants in various municipalities in Wisconsin and throughout the U.S. So our quick quiz on the bottom here is, which product would be best for correcting a low phosphorus garden? And if you guessed bone meal, you're right on track. Providing nitrogen, but little phosphorus or potassium. And if you've said blood meal, that's pretty good. High percentage of nitrogen relative to P and K. And contributing organic matter, but little nutrients overall. And that one we can look to the tree leaves. Good. Inorganic fertilizers. These are things that are usually mined or manufactured. Microorganisms are usually not required to degrade them. They have the potential to cause environmental damage when misused, but many slow-release options are available, and we really prefer, if you're going to use inorganic fertilizers, look for ones that have slow release, and then they can perform similarly or better than the natural organic fertilizers. So here's an example of some inorganic fertilizers. And again, take a look at the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium content of these four options. And go down and look at our quick quiz. Which product would be best for providing a phosphorus-free fertilizer? That one's easy. General Turf has no phosphorus in it, so no chance of losing that product to or increasing phosphorus into the waterways if that's used. Now, Wisconsin does have a ban on phosphorus applications to lawns, but not to gardens. So if you do want to apply phosphorus to your lawn, you need to have a soil test showing that it's required. Or you can use phosphorus during the first year of establishing a new lawn, because phosphorus is so important for helping those new roots grow. Okay, which product is best for supplying potassium for hardiness, winter hardiness? This one looks like you have a few options here. The Winterizer Turf has 15% potassium, but so does the Miracle-Gro and the Starter Turf. However, those products also have a relatively high amount of phosphorus. So if that phosphorus isn't needed, we'll probably want to stick to that Winterizer Turf fertilizer. Why do we have so many turf fertilizers on here? One thing I've found by looking at the specialty stores and garden centers is that often these turf fertilizers, I can find one that has high nitrogen, I can find one that has low phosphorus but high potassium, and I can find one that has high phosphorus. So I can find almost any variety I want. They usually have options that contain high percentages of slow release nitrogen, and they tend to be on a per area basis more cost effective than some of the specialty garden fertilizers. So in a lot of cases, I can imagine finding a good use for a turf fertilizer in a garden if I understand what I'm looking for. Okay, which product is best for providing organic matter? That's a trick question because none of these are going to do that. These are inorganic fertilizers and they are not going to provide organic matter in and of themselves.